Well, welcome to our first panel of the day. This one will focus on evaluating U.S. foreign policy since the end of the Cold War. If we want to improve our foreign policy outcomes, analyzing the recent past is a good place to start. And to do this, I'm joined by Dr. Kathleen Hicks and Dr. John Mearsheimer. Kathleen Hicks is Senior Vice President, Henry A. Kissinger Chair, and Director of the International Security Program at the Center for Strategic and International Studies. Her most recent publication is a report on U.S. Army force posture in Europe. Welcome, Kathleen.
Thank you.
John Mearsheimer is the R. Wendell Harrison Distinguished Service Professor of Political Science at the University of Chicago, where he has taught since 1982. He is also the author of numerous books and has a forthcoming piece with Steve Walt in the July-August issue of Foreign Affairs entitled The Case for Offshore Balancing. He is also the author of The Tragedy of Great Power Politics, a book widely used in classrooms across the country. Let's start big picture and then narrow down. Has there been a coherent theme to U.S. foreign policy over the last 25 years? In other words, do you think that U.S. foreign policy has seen more continuity than differences across the four presidential administrations we've had since the end of the Cold War? And if so, what have been some of the key features of this approach? Why don't you start us off, John Mearsheimer?
I do think there has been a consistent foreign policy across all administrations, both Democrat and Republican, since the end of the Cold War. Lots of people like to say there's a big difference between Barack Obama and George W. Bush, but I basically see them as Tweedledee and Tweedledum, which I think is consistent with what Andy said beforehand. And the basic foreign policy here is one of liberal hegemony. And it has two dimensions to it. The first is that we're bent on militarily dominating the entire globe. There's no place on the planet that doesn't matter to the indispensable nation. We care about every nook and cranny of the planet, and we're interested in being militarily dominant here, there, and everywhere. So that's the first dimension. The second dimension is we're deeply committed to transforming the world. We're deeply committed to making everybody look like us. As Andy said in his opening comments, focusing on Frank Fukuyama's famous article, there was a deep-seated belief, starting in the early period of the post-Cold War era, that we were destined to have a planet that was populated by nothing but liberal democracies, countries that looked like us. And because we had this big stick, we could use it to facilitate or to speed up the spread of democratization. So we're heavily into regime change in places like the Middle East and other places on the planet as well. And again, the purpose here is to make the world one big security community, which is another way of saying make it one big group of liberal democracies who will love each other, and thus that will eliminate war.
Kathleen, do you see continuity over the last four administrations, and what do you think are some of the key elements?
Sure. I actually think there's been incredible continuity since the end of the Second World War, and it just continued on post-Cold War. And that's really, to start really where John started, it's about the advancement of U.S. interests by leading in the world. I think that has been a very consistent theme, and how each administration has pursued that, particularly the four following the end of the Cold War, has definitely varied which of those interests they've been most attuned to: economic, human rights and international order, and or U.S. physical security and the security of its allies. And how they've chosen to implement that, I think, has varied to some extent. But there's an incredible continuity, I think, of 70-plus years in American foreign policy. The big questions don't tend to come at that major consensus level,
right,
which is itself challenged, of course. But the big questions tend to come, how do we implement that?
Sure. Now, do you think that this approach has worked to make America safer? Has it been a net positive approach?
The overall approach of the U.S. engaging in the world in order to secure its interests, I do think, has been beneficial to the United States. It's hard to prove all counterfactuals, which I think is the point of this panel, which will be challenging. But I think the U.S. has been better off rather than worse off by virtue of its strengths its power militarily, economically, demographically, societally have benefited the U.S., and the fact that we use that to lead in the world in, with many bad mistakes having been made along the way, I think in general and on net have been beneficial to our citizens.
Right, so is it's an A or a B on the scale?
What are you grading? The overall U.S. foreign policy?
Yeah.
I think overall U.S. foreign policy is at best a B. I think the idea, again, of that consistent theme of engaging in the world and recognizing that we advance our own interests by looking beyond our borders and thinking about how to engage, that I would say is a strong and positive A in terms of a general principle.
So a superior approach, need to improve a little bit on the execution, but
well,
still,
that's an understatement of what I just said, but yes.
John, what's your assessment about whether this is working?
The initial question that Will asked was whether or not our foreign policy in the post-Cold War period has made us more secure. Now, this is a tricky question for me to answer because I think the United States is a remarkably secure country, and there's almost nothing that it can do that threatens its security in any meaningful way. First of all, we are physically separated from Europe and Asia, where the other great powers have historically been, by two giant moats. Secondly, we have thousands of nuclear weapons, which are the ultimate deterrent. And third, if you believe that we live in a unipolar world, which almost everybody believes, that means that by definition, we are the only great power on the planet. We don't have any great power competitors. Does it get any better than this? The United States has been, over time, largely because of geography, but not exclusively because of geography, the most secure great power on the planet. But today, it is the most secure in its entire history. And the reason that we can run around the world engaging in all these lost causes, go back to Andy's previous talk, is because we're so remarkably secure. The reason the American people basically don't care is because it doesn't matter very much. So we are remarkably secure. The people who are paying the price are in places like the Middle East and places like Europe. The amount of death and destruction that we've brought to the Middle East is mind-boggling. Just hard to believe. Just take Syria. This is a country with 23 million people. 23 million people. 7 million of those people are internally displaced. And 4 million of those people have left the country. That's 11 million out of 23 million people. And most estimates are that 250,000 are dead. I guess the number is now up closer to 400,000. We've broken the country into a variety of parts. And furthermore, you know what's happening? Refugees are streaming into Europe, threatening to wreck the European Union. As I tell my European friends when I go to Europe, this gift is compliments of Uncle Sam and his boneheaded policies in the Middle East. We've got the Atlantic Ocean. Those refugees can't get to us. They go to Europe. They spread out over the rest of the Middle East. So the point I would make is we have done a disastrous job in the Middle East, but it has not hurt American security in any meaningful way because we are a remarkably secure country, largely because of geography.
Kathleen, do you think John's being too pessimistic here about what American foreign policy has been able to accomplish or not accomplish, according to him?
Well, just to continue on the Middle East, which is not a shining light of American foreign policy, I think it's very unfair to sort of refer to the troubles in Syria today, for example, as wholly the inheritance brought to them by the United States. There are many, there are many fathers of failure for Syria, Iran, Russia, the United States, Assad, it can go on and on, really. The Arab states who have supplied weapons and money over time to jihadists. So it's hard for me to sort of look at the United States as this power that can control all events everywhere in the world. In fact, I think that's counter to how you would view it anyway. And so on that basis alone, I think it's hard for us to own that. Now, has the United States made mistakes, again, in foreign policy? Absolutely, the Iraq invasion was a mistake. how we handled Afghanistan after 9/11, I think, has been an enduring challenge, perhaps, is a polite way to put it. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, the issue set over Libya has been another challenge. So that's just picking a few of the more recent. Right. Obviously, we could go back over the 90s as well. But I think the United States, you know, my view, less normatively and more practically, is that the United States is somewhat destined to being a selective engager. We have a democracy. Our democracy at times, our public, and most importantly, their elected officials at times want to use force. We can debate the wisdom of that, and it's right to do that. We have to do that as citizens. But it's going to happen, and people in this room probably disagree among themselves about which of those were valid and which were not valid. I think the question is, do you have the capability to do that, and how do you frame it in a way that doesn't threaten that security, that those advantages maybe that the United States has? The only other thing I want to add is that the United States is not entirely contained within the continental United States. I'd hate to think of the folks in Hawaii thinking of themselves as outside the moat. But so we are complicated in our own geography and in our alliances. We have made alliance commitments over time that, you know, create an imperative at a vital interest level to engage, to help in defense of those allies. So the alliance system is itself something to question whether it creates more value, which I believe, or it creates more costs.
Great.
Yeah, I'd just like to respond to a number of Kathleen's points. First of all, I don't think we're a selective engager. We're an all azimuth engager. There's just no place on the planet where we don't engage. Not militarily in every case, but in many cases militarily. Second, I didn't mean to say, and I don't think I said, that we were totally responsible for what's happened in Syria. But there are five big cases of regime change in the Middle East, all five of which we have been involved in. Iraq, Afghanistan, Syria, Libya, and Egypt. Failure, 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 failure. We're almost wholly responsible for creating the mess in Afghanistan. We're almost wholly responsible for creating the mess in Iraq, which, by the way, led to the creation of ISIS. We played a key role in Syria. Remember, in August of 2011, August 8, 2011, Barack Obama said Assad had to go. We funneled all sorts of money in there. We were supporting jihadis directly or indirectly. We've played a key role in fueling that civil war. We played a key role, not the only role, in Libya. And we played a key role in toppling the government in Egypt. We professed that we're interested in promoting democracy around the world. Well, we got a democratically elected government in Egypt. Oh my God, it just happened to be the Muslim Brotherhood. Well, you know how that works. When the United States gets a democratically elected government that it doesn't like, we topple it. And then we brought some military thug back in power. Of course, we did help get rid of Mubarak because we were going to promote democracy, but look what we have now. So the big five examples of regime change, democracy promotion, which, by the way, happened under both George W. Bush and Barack Obama, are all failures.
Kathleen, do you want to respond? There's a lot
there.
Well,
there's a lot, yeah. I don't know if it helps to go into the particulars of the Egypt piece. I think I'm not sure how the United States created the coup, if you will.
I just said we helped facilitate
Egypt. Okay, so yeah. I think it's best to move
forward.
Sure,
we can move. Yeah, sure. So, yeah, let's think historically again, because we want to evaluate here. Michael Mandelbaum, a professor at Johns Hopkins University and author of the new book Mission Failure, argues that there was a sharp break in the U.S.'s approach to foreign policy in the post-Cold War world. In particular, he argues that the U.S.'s post-Gulf War protection mission for the Kurds, called Operation Provide Comfort, led to a shift from an interest-based policy to a values-based policy. So my question, Kathleen, is Mandelbaum correct that there was a major break in the history of American foreign policy? And if Mandelbaum is correct, was this a positive change that has supported America's vital interests?
Values have always been some part of U.S. foreign policy. It's often not the most convincing part. If you look at the U.S. history, for example, about going into World War II or even how the United States dealt with Russia at the very beginning of the Cold War, there were value elements within that, but often it's the interest case that was most compelling. So I'm not sure I would say that that's a major break. I think it is fair to say that that is largely a value-based approach that was undertaken. In the particulars, was it appropriate to look to protect the Kurds? I think the warning shot, if you will, about the United States having an interest in a situation in which a country had already been invaded, Iraq into Kuwait, and then indicating an intent to contain Iraq, I think that was an appropriate response for the United States to pursue.
Mm-hmm. John?
I have a somewhat different view than Michael Mandelbaum on what happened in the Middle East, although I must say I haven't read the book. I'm basing my comments on what Will just said. I think the way you want to think about our Middle East policy is that from roughly 1945 to 1968, we depended on the British to defend our interests in the Middle East. And then when the British said they were withdrawing all their forces from east of Suez in 68, we turned mainly to the Shah of Iran. And he did the heavy lifting in the region for us from 68 to 79. Then in 1979, when you had the revolution in Iran and the Shah was overthrown and the Ayatollah Khomeini came to power, the United States decided that for the first time they had to build the military capability to deal with the region. And what we did was we developed the Rapid Deployment Force, which was an offshore balancing capability, or as some of you remember at the time, we referred to as an over-the-horizon capability. It was a very smart way to do business. Given that we no longer had the British, we no longer could depend on the Iranians, and we had to do it ourselves, we developed an offshore balancing capability, okay? However, after the first Gulf War, in roughly 1993, we made the first fatal mistake, and we jettisoned the policy of offshore balancing and adopted a policy of dual containment, where we permanently stationed large-scale forces in the Middle East, and we took it upon ourselves to contain both Iran and Iraq. And this, of course, played a key role in precipitating what happened on 9/11. After 9/11, we abandoned dual containment and we adopted an even more ambitious strategy, which was regime change, which is what I was just talking about. And regime change, Will, is where you get into the business of foisting your values on other people. So if you think about what's happened in terms of our Middle East policy over time, we've gone from a world in which we depended on others to where we depended on ourselves but kept our distance, to one where we went to dual containment, and now we're heavily into the business of regime change. And the question you want to ask yourself is, what have been the consequences? The consequences have been disastrous. And what we ought to do, the Middle East or the Persian Gulf still matters as a strategic interest for the United States. So we still need some military capability. But what we ought to do is go back to an offshore balancing capability, an over-the-horizon capability, and get out of people's faces, certainly get out of the business of social engineering.
Now, Kathleen, you mentioned alliances earlier, and that's a good place for us to go here, I think, now. Were the NATO enlargements that took place starting in 1999 with the inclusion of Poland, Hungary, and the Czech Republic, and continuing the addition of the Baltics and other states in 2004 and another round in 2009, were these enlargements prudent? In other words, have the benefits outweighed the costs of those alliance extensions, expanding the zone of peace, if you will?
Sure. Look, I think there is, at the values level, something to expanding mm-hmm. peace across a Europol and free. I think that's a good, thought. Mm-hmm. I think each of the enlargement rounds, though, pressed further into the question about what the risk tolerance level was for NATO mm-hmm. and what the risk tolerance level was and is for Russia. So first round, I'm actually was completely fine with the first mm-hmm. round. I think second round, a little more questionable. By the third round, you have to start thinking about the gap that existed between the enthusiasm for enlargement and the apparent willingness in terms of the spending of the allies and their own capabilities for developing military wherewithal on the Eastern Front, there was a gap that was increasing there, that there was no obvious and evident way in which NATO was looking to close it. So, you know, had NATO had put more enthusiasm behind that as much as they did behind the rhetoric, I think, you know, perhaps even then you could have argued that these were good expansions. Mm-hmm. I think it's questionable whether that was wise, and certainly it was wise not to proceed on Georgia and Ukraine when that issue arose following the Georgia invasion by Russia. Now I think the real question is, how do we make sure that we do have no gap between the actual NATO alliance territory mm-hmm. that we have said we're going to defend under Article 5 and the capabilities we have collectively to do that? I think NATO has, Russia has created a good amount of political cohesion inside NATO such as it can at 28, and I think you're seeing some movement toward that. That's been very positive. For those who are outside, however, of formal NATO membership, it's a very tricky area to be in. They've been given a sense of assurances about their ability eventually to join. I think their own democracies, economies, militaries are not progressed to the point where it makes sense for them to join anyway, so in some ways the point is moot. But there is this unanswered expectation out there, and I think there has to be some kind of an ability to understand the Russian viewpoint about their region, while also respecting the self-identification rights of countries around them to blossom in the way they choose to. That does not mean we need to offer them NATO membership.
Sure. Let me push you on that a little bit. If Georgia and Ukraine had been more fully embraced by the United States and the West, perhaps they would be in a better position today. Wouldn't that be what the advocates of enlarging NATO further would say, is that there's very little real risk of a problem, and if we could only get keep expanding these zones, then in a way that will improve the security environment in Europe and also improve the domestic economies and domestic political situation in those states?
Well, as I said before, in some ways the point is moot because Ukraine had not advanced mm-hmm. in such a way that was eligible for NATO membership by any real metric. Mm-hmm. And of course, the at the time of the invasion of Crimea, the real issue was the EU, which you can argue about whether or not that was linked in the Russians' minds to NATO. But regardless, it was not really mm-hmm. about NATO at that time in any immediate sense. So the Ukrainians and the Georgians are not ready to join NATO right now. I think this is the question, though, going forward, which is how do we think through if they reach a point somehow where they are, again, economically, societally, and militarily capable enough, do we think it's worth it in terms of that big value mm-hmm. to proceed, where we know the Russians have an extreme sensitivity to extending it, in particular to those two nations and some others. There's less of a neuralgia, I think, in Russia about the Baltic states, and there's less about the eastern flank countries that are in. But now we really are up against areas where Russia has, for instance, with Ukraine, considered Ukraine Russian territory. Now, I'm not legitimizing that. Mm-hmm. I don't believe that that justifies in any way, this fear that may or may not have existed in Russia justifies in any way Russian actions in Ukraine. But I do think it's a real, we have to take it into account. You know, Russia is a major power. We need to take account of how they feel about
constraints matter.
Things around, so we have, as we look at NATO expansion going forward, I think it's a real question as to whether the value that we want to achieve is worth the cost, at least in the next 5 years or so.
Sure. John, what's your view of NATO enlargement, one, two, or three, or all the above?
Well, I basically think that the United States should turn NATO over to the Europeans, but that hasn't happened and is not likely to happen in the immediate future. So the question is, what do I think of NATO enlargement? I basically agree with Kathleen, who I interpret to say that the first and second tranches worked, that we got away with it. But the real trouble started at the April 2008 NATO meeting in Bucharest, where we said in the final communique that NATO that Georgia and Ukraine would become part of NATO. This enraged the Russians, and it led to the war in August of 2008 between Russia and Georgia, and it has played a key role in precipitating the crisis between Russia and the West over Ukraine. What I find remarkable about all of this is that if you think about Georgia and you think about Ukraine, we have demonstrated clearly that we do not consider those countries vital strategic interests, and we are not willing to fight for them. We didn't fight for Georgia in August 2008, and even all of the hawks in this city were not calling for fighting over Ukraine. You didn't hear John McCain calling for a war over Ukraine. He didn't call for us to intervene. And that's because Ukraine is not a vital strategic interest for us. But if you think about it, we were talking about including them in NATO, which meant giving them an Article 5 guarantee. Why in God's name would anyone who's taken Strategy 101 or Geopolitics 101 give an Article 5 guarantee to a country that is not a vital strategic interest? And the answer, of course, is because basic realpolitik, basic geopolitics, just doesn't matter much in this town. Liberal hegemony dominates. And what we were doing here was expanding the security community eastward. Talk to Michael McFaul, who I actually know quite well, who was Barack Obama's ambassador to Moscow from 2012 to 2014. Michael will tell you that he told Vladimir Putin and his lieutenants on numerous occasions that NATO was no threat to Russia. It was not intended for the purpose of containing Russia. What we were doing was expanding the security community eastward. This was a liberal agenda. We were spreading democracy. We were spreading institutions. We were spreading economic interdependence. And in the end, maybe even Russia could be part of this giant security community. No sense of realpolitik. And of course, Putin thinks simply in terms of realpolitik, and he and his lieutenants saw NATO expansion as a threat. So really, just to embellish what you said, Kathleen, I think what happened in the case of Ukraine and Georgia is that it was a bridge too far.
Mm-hmm. So moving south and east, what do you think the lessons of the Iraq War are today? Is it that we shouldn't have done something like this in the first place, or we won and then we squandered that victory? That's what John McCain said, right? He said in 2014, we had it won thanks to the surge, it was won. What are the lessons? I mean, and I think this applies to Libya as well. Should the United States be doing more, or should we be doing less in these areas, particularly when it relates to American interests? Kathleen?
Well, I do think it's very context and country dependent. So I say that at the beginning only because where you ended. I don't want to make a blanket statement.
Sure.
I don't think we should have invaded and sought to regime change and, in fact, change the regime in Iraq. I was not in favor of Libya, but I will say I worked in the Defense Department at the time, and our position as a department, as Secretary Gates subsequently made quite clear, is that we did not support undertaking action in Libya. But that does not mean that in all such circumstances at all times, I wouldn't think it's appropriate to use U.S. military power in that way. But I don't think the stakes were there in either case, and we were very stretched. In the case of Libya, we were very stretched already in Iraq and Afghanistan. But now, having said that, there are plenty of lessons to learn even after that point. I don't think that's where the debate should stop. I think the conduct of Iraq and Afghanistan and the lack of conduct, I guess, of Libya, all point to a weakness in the way in which we think about those stakes. That idea that we have that ideal of what we want to do, maybe it's driven by ideology, maybe it's even driven by realpolitik. Whatever it's driven by, it's not often followed up by the forces needed to consolidate the gains. And it's not followed by a, you know, what the Europeans call comprehensive approach, a strategy that's integrating the civilian and military elements of power, governance in the nation, et cetera, in a way that isn't just spending a lot of U.S. taxpayer dollar for lack of effect. I think we can do that better, even if we make a bad choice, or it's a debatable choice, maybe is a better way to put it. That doesn't mean that we can't secure gains, but we have to be ready to invest to do that, and that's back to the question of what do Americans want their role to be in the world, and where does it make sense to put that investment?
Sure. John, what are the lessons of Iraq to you?
Well, we should have never gone into Iraq to begin with. There's no question that the United States, given its military power, can run around the world and knock off regimes with relative ease. But the real question comes, what happens afterwards? And what has to happen if you're going to make the mission a success is you have to do nation building. And nation building is a remarkably difficult process. We're not even really good at it back here in the United States. You can come to my home state of Illinois and just see how badly we are at nation building in Illinois. And the idea that the United States of America, especially the US military, I can say this as somebody who spent 10 years in the American military, it's a very crude instrument. The idea that you can take this instrument and knock off a regime in a place like Afghanistan or Iraq and do meaningful nation building with it, is foolishness in the extreme. So we made a huge mistake, and we should never do anything like that again. And what I find quite remarkable is that most of the people who took us into Iraq grew up during the Vietnam War. To put it in slightly different terms, they came of age during the Vietnam War. You would have think that they had learned their lesson back then and would have stayed away from Iraq because it had the same basic essential elements for trouble. Second point I'd make on this, and this is the argument that people in the establishment, especially in the Republican Party, make, that we had won the war by 2011 and Obama lost it. Look, when George Bush announced the surge, he said that there were two criteria for success. One is you had to tamp down the violence, and two, there had to be a political reconciliation, mainly between the Shia and the Sunni. And what has not happened, we did tamp down the violence for sure, and major credit to the administration, the Bush administration, and then the Obama administration, and to the US military. But what we did not do was foster political reconciliation. The George W. Bush administration, to its credit, and the Barack Obama administration, to its credit, understood that we had to foster political reconciliation if we were going to get out of there and the place was not going to come unglued. But neither one of them could do it. And of course, after we left in 2011, it went to hell in a handbasket. And you now have a country that's effectively broken into three parts, one of which is ISIS. And the principal causes of this is the absence of political reconciliation. So we didn't win. We didn't do what President Bush said we had to do to make the surge work. So to blame President Obama and say that President Bush had won the war is another one of these idiotic arguments that seem to have so much credence here inside the bubble.
Kathleen, how do you think we could improve phase four of these operations? You talked about increasing state capacity, or you referenced that. Can we do that, or is the kind of candle not worth the game?
Well, I'll go all the way back to my statements earlier at the beginning that, I do approach this somewhat pragmatically, quite frankly, which is the United States seems to find itself. Maybe that's the using a passive voice. We seem to find ourselves somehow.
We do.
Miraculously in these situations over and over again. So the game is absolutely worth the candle. We have American lives that are on the line, certainly, again, taxpayer dollars. And it makes sense to, not every time we do this say, well, that we don't like that nation building. That was really awful. And we always say, oh, we're so bad at it. Everybody's bad at it. It's not an easy thing to go into another country and occupy it and run it. And it's much harder in some cases than in others. But we do need to have that capacity, at some level, at some prudent level. I'm not saying that we stand up and maintain a gigantic armed forces simply for that purpose. But these, what's often called, as you say, phase four operations, stabilization approaches, consolidating gains, whatever you like to call it, that is the nature of warfare. Warfare does not end with a, you know, a flag on a carrier, and it ends with a political reconciliation and approach that is sustainable. And military backing for that is an important piece, whether that's the U.S. military itself or partners on the ground who are doing that. It has, you know, that consolidating gain stage is absolutely essential for U.S. foreign policy, and it's very frustrating that we continually demoted, if you will. I think of myself as an offshore balancer who likes to make sure that we can follow on and consolidate. I think you have to have both. I mean, in the Middle East, absolutely offshore balancer is the preference. A big footprint in the Middle East is not helpful to the United States on many levels, politically, militarily, otherwise. But wherever we are in the world, again, if we find ourselves in a position where we have vested our interest and we have to consolidate those gains, we need to have that capability to do so. And a lot of that does fall on the ground forces.
Okay, John?
I was just gonna ask Kathleen, I don't understand what you think our interests are in regime change, why we have to have this capability to do nation building.
Sure.
I mean, as I said before, and I'd like to know why you disagree with me, the United States is a remarkably secure great power. Who cares what happens in Syria? Who cares what happens in
sure.
Egypt? And as long as one country doesn't dominate all the region and control the oil, why do we really care? And why do we have to get involved in social engineering? I just sort of don't understand what the rationale is here.
So, okay. So I think the way, I take this on two points. One is sort of the direct issue of phase four, and then I'll roll all the way back to why things in the Middle East might matter when they're, you know, so, because they're related, but a little different. So again, on the phase four piece, whether it's because, not all stabilization operations are about regime change. So I think we should break that first of all, right? Because if nations can have a collapse on the inside. You may decide that, again, political powers may decide that you want to engage in that country. Let's say Pakistan were to fall apart, which, by the way, would be absolutely horrific as a stabilization operation. Mm-hmm. So hopefully that doesn't happen. But, you know, that's the kind of thing where you could imagine a situation where it's not actually a regime change, certainly not a regime change imposed from the outside, maybe is the way to put it. And yet you find yourself wanting to stabilize a country. It could be just because of humanitarian disaster. Often it's a small, what we have found in the past is it's not that you are going into regime change or you're going in to undertake a major effort. It might be because you fool yourself that you're going to do a small thing and then you're there, right? And then it expands and you, back to my point, you have lives on the line. So that's the first set of issues. Should you have that capability? From the 19th century forward, the United States has had to have some kind of capability, whether it was because we were moving west across the continent or so. I would love for the world to change. I look forward to that day. It has not changed to date, and I think the prudent thing, it's not a huge investment for the United States, is to maintain a capability to stabilize. Mm-hmm. The other question, yep. The issue you raise is sort of threats in the Middle East, and there I think we probably do differ. I take your point about America being remarkably secure. I think that's generally true. I do think, though, that we can't just think in great power senses about what can create threats to American interests. I think the threat from nuclear weapons is probably greater than you do. I think there is the capacity, will, and network that allows for nuclear weapons proliferation from non-state actors that could come to the United States. That's one piece. I do think the collapse of the Middle East in general can create opportunities for hegemons to arise. Iran would be the most obvious. I don't hold out that there couldn't be others. So I think that we do have an interest, as you say, in the Persian Gulf. We have partners there who I think it makes sense to support, but to make sure they do it in a way that's actually helpful, which is a challenge. That has to be a line at some point between what constitutes is what I call selective engagement, versus isolationism, and what constitutes, you know, an imprudent investment of U.S. Power and energy on something that it can't control.
Let's let Kathleen have the last word on that, at least here, because we won't have this conversation outside of this meeting for the coming future. But let me ask you, Kathleen, again, to follow up on the Middle East. Do you think we'll look back at the recent Iran nuclear deal as a success? And I know a lot depends on what happens in the future, but was this the right move for the United States at this moment in time?
I don't know that we'll look back on it as a success for the reasons you say. I do think it was the right move at this time.
Okay.
I think there was a value to be had in creating a regime under which you can monitor Iranian nuclear capability. I do not think Iran obtaining nuclear weapons is in the U.S. interest. I think this was the best way to prevent that right now.
Okay.
The alternative really was to undertake military action. Which, for all the reasons that I think John has laid out very well, is problematic for overall interests in the world at this point in time.
Mm-hmm. Okay. John, Iran deal?
Yeah, I think it's hard to say what this will lead to. If you look at what Donald Trump and virtually all the Republican candidates have said, it appears that once we have a Republican in the White House, they're going to tear up the deal. And if that's the case, it won't be successful. Hillary Clinton has defended the deal, but she's made it very clear that this is not going to lead to a rapprochement with Iran. And I think that given that the deal really only goes for about 15 years, that it's imperative that there be some sort of rapprochement between the United States and Iran over that 15 years, so that when the deal comes to an end, the Iranians have no incentive to get nuclear weapons.
Mm-hmm.
As Ehud Barak, the Israeli prime minister said, former prime minister said at one point about Iran, he said the reason to think that Iran is pursuing nuclear weapons is because it makes so much sense.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And he fully understood that from an Iranian point of view, when you're surrounded by countries like the United States and Israel that have their gun sights on you, having nuclear weapons is the smart thing to do. Well, given that basic logic, which almost everybody who studies deterrence understands, what you want to do is do everything you can to ameliorate the threat against Iran. And it seems to me, just looking at Hillary Clinton's comments and looking at the Republican Party's comments and sort of looking even where the body politic is on this, that it's going to be hard to work out any form of rapprochement between the United States and Iran. So even if the deal does not come unglued over the next 15 years, it still may be the case at the end of 15 years, the Iranians have a very powerful set of incentives to acquire nuclear weapons. And I think at that point in time, it will be impossible for us to put together a coalition of powers that will put sanctions on Iran as happened in the past. I think relations between the United States and China and the United States and Russia have reached the point where neither the Chinese or the Russians would be willing to cooperate with us against Iran.
Mm-hmm.
And in fact, if you look at what's happening in terms of Chinese-Iranian relations, I think there's a reasonably good chance in 15 years those two countries will be in bed with each other. You notice that Xi Jinping was in Tehran in January of this year, January 2016, and the Chinese and the Iranians signed 17 different agreements. Given where U.S.-Iranian relations are and appear to be headed, and given where U.S.-China relations are and appear to be headed, it seems to me that there's a real possibility that China and Iran will come together against the United States. So this is all to say, I think it's going to be hard to put a sanctions regime back in place. So we could be in real trouble 15 years out if we're not careful.
Okay. We only have a few minutes left, but I want to kind of get back to some of these bigger questions. One is, what foreign policy decision in this 25-year period that we're evaluating has yielded the greatest benefits for the United States? And what foreign policy decision do you think was the biggest mistake? Kathleen?
Well, the mistake's easier. That's Iraq. And even though you told me, I think, that you were going to ask that other question, I really haven't thought about it. The biggest, so I don't want to claim then that with that little thought, what I think is the biggest, but I think a success, if you will, a significant success has been the alliance structure that the United States has maintained. Again, putting to the side the issues over the enlargement of NATO, the ability of the United States to come out of the Cold War and still have, I think, really an incredible asymmetric advantage in terms of its alliances in Asia, its partnerships throughout the Middle East, and a benign environment, if you will, in and around the United States in the Western Hemisphere, and then, of course, NATO. I think that's been a tremendous benefit to the United States. When we were attacked on 9/11, whether you agree with how the conduct of the Afghanistan war occurred, we had our NATO allies there with us, fighting. They've lost over 1,000 NATO members, have 1,000 deaths in Afghanistan. That was our fight, and our allies went there with us. When you look at Asia, I think you've had a tremendous advantage to the United States in terms of its ability to protect its commerce and to look after its interests by virtue of, again, Australia, South Korea, and Japan in particular. So I guess I would say that ability to maintain that despite what was the absence of a pressing threat, which is normally why you have a strong alliance. I think that's been very much to our benefit and has helped us in the economic realm, trade, and other areas.
John, success, biggest mistake?
At first blanche, I'm tempted to agree, or inclined to agree, with Kathleen that Iraq was the biggest mistake that we made. It's kind of hard not to agree with you on that. But I think that after a few more years, we may think that the crisis over Ukraine was the biggest mistake we made. I'm actually very nervous about the situation in Europe. The Russians have thousands of nuclear weapons. They're scared. And we're doing a number of things in Eastern Europe that they view as very provocative. And I've spent a lot of time studying great power behavior. And great powers tend to be paranoid. You cannot underestimate how scared they get. And when you take a country like Russia that has a sense of vulnerability, and you begin to push them towards the ledge, you get in their face, you're asking for trouble, right? It's possible that they might use those nuclear weapons. It's possible you could have a real war in Eastern Europe. And this makes me very nervous, right? Iraq is a disaster, but the consequences for the United States, as I said earlier, just not that great because we're so secure. But once you start introducing nuclear weapons into the equation, it's a different story. And I would also add that because the Cold War is in the distant past, most people, especially younger people, haven't thought a lot about nuclear weapons and nuclear deterrence. And they tend to be quite cavalier in their comments about nuclear weapons. And this makes me very nervous. So I think that you're right from the perspective of today that Iraq was the biggest mistake. But I think the Ukraine crisis, which goes back to your point about the third tranche of NATO expansion, may be seen as the biggest problem. I think with regard to our successes, I think of the world in terms of three areas: East Asia, the Gulf, or the greater Middle East, and Europe. I think we've made a mess in Europe and in the Gulf or the greater Middle East, as we've talked about here. And the one area that we've not talked about is East Asia. Mm-hmm. And the reason we've not talked about East Asia is because we haven't caused any trouble out there.
We're working on it.
Well, I would also note that the Chinese are doing all sorts of things that are going to cause trouble as well. But I think that we've done a very good job, both under the Bush the Clinton administration, the Bush administration, and the Obama administration, at managing affairs in East Asia. But I think that's the one area of the world where there's going to be big trouble in the future, and where the United States is going to be heavily involved. I know Will and I have some disagreements on whether that's good or bad, but even though I'm an offshore balancer, I'm deeply committed to being involved in East Asia for the purposes of containing the Chinese. But that's how I'd answer that question.
Sure. Well, great. We're going to move to questions and answers now. That was great, but now let's get some audience participation here. I can hardly see you all, so.
Yes. So I'm Monica Toft from Oxford and Princeton. So thanks, John and Kathleen. Thank you for the panel. So one I would add, one success, which we don't talk about, and I thought it was going to come into the history books, and Andy, you've made reference to it, was George Sr. and sort of dealing with the Soviet Union when it was collapsing, the paranoia. And hopefully he gets a little bit more credit and his team for that. But I'm wondering, you know, listening to this for the past 25 years, do we need a new vocabulary? So we keep talking about geopolitics, I know they matter. But have there been any changes, you know, according to the panels, where we're going to need a new vocabulary? Is containment, rollback, or shore balancing, is it enough?
I'll go first. I think that George H.W. Bush and the people who worked with him did a terrific job in terms of ending the Cold War. I think there's almost universal agreement on that. They weren't perfect, but they did as good a job as you could have expected. And but what we're talking about up here today and what we talk about in the general discourse is the post-Cold War period. And that was sort of the final installment of the Cold War story. So that's why it didn't get brought up. With regard to a new vocabulary, my argument is that what we need to do is bring back the old vocabulary. See, we have introduced a new vocabulary since 1989. It's the liberal vocabulary. It's the vocabulary of the liberal imperialists. And it has led to no end of trouble. And what we need to do is think in terms of geopolitics. Think in terms of realpolitik. If we did that, we wouldn't have this problem with Russia today. And by the way, when you're dealing with the Chinese, you want to understand that these are people who are realists to the core. If you go out there and you start thinking and talking with all this liberal rhetoric, you're going to get yourself into a lot of trouble. You want to think and you want to act and you want to talk in terms of that old vocabulary when you are focusing on East Asia, and again, when you're focusing on Europe and the Gulf as well.
Kathy? Well, John's answer makes me think of a quip that a friend of mine, a fellow academic friend, likes to make, that too many people in Washington slept through deterrence class, which I think is to your point. So,
or never took it.
Yes, that's right. So I don't know that it's about vocabulary, but I think where maybe your question in general is going, I'm probably with you. I think there are things that are true through time, power dynamics, ways in which organizations, units, people, countries act, that are constant and are the same vocabulary. At the same time, I do think there is a whole set of elements changing in the world. It would be silly to ignore that. Obviously, the information age is at the center of that. And I don't know what that vocabulary looks like or how that, if it folds neatly into the old vocabulary, that's great. It might. But it certainly, at a minimum, complicates how we apply our approaches in the modern age in a way that Metternich didn't have to worry about. So I think there's something to that general point, and I just don't know what that looks like, and it might be another decade before it starts to become clearer out of the academic literature.
Ray McGovern with a question. There's an elephant in the room here. This is not the first such conference that I've seen it not mentioned, but how can we possibly talk about U.S. foreign policy towards Syria or Iraq without mentioning the name of a country called Israel, which has been such a predominant influence in the crafting of these policies, the intent being to dismember Syria and Iraq quite successfully. Thank you very much. Why is Israel banned from discussion in this room?
Well, certainly no question is banned because we're interested in exploring all kinds of ideas. So there's no banning of any of this. But Kathleen, do you?
Yeah, it's not every day someone wants to jump on the Israel question, but I'll be happy. Similarly, I certainly am not self-editing Israel out of my answers. I mean, Israel is an important consideration when the U.S. thinks about how it approaches the Middle East and the importance the U.S. has placed on the survival of Israel as a nation. I think that has been probably part of that general bipartisan consensus. I certainly believe that. But I don't think it maybe hangs over, but I have to infer from your question, I don't think it hangs over every action and move that we consider in the Middle East. Just as Russia is a consideration for pretty much everything we do in Europe, you know, we are always thinking about the Saudis, the Israelis, other actors, in even Russia, when we think about our actions in the Middle East. But I don't think U.S. foreign policy is controlled by Israel, or is that, you know, that our democracy is fundamentally challenged by the influence that Israel plays.
I'd make a couple points, Ray. First of all, if I was giving a talk on our failure in the Middle East, another failure that I would have put up on my list was our failure to get a two-state solution. Both the the Clinton administration, the George W. Bush administration, and the Obama administration have gone to great lengths to push the Israelis to accept a two-state solution. We think a two-state solution is in Israel's interest, and we certainly think it's in our interest, because it takes this whole conflict with the Palestinians off the table, and we view that quite correctly as a source of trouble for us, right? So we pushed really hard, and we failed. It's just another example of a failure. Second point I'd make to you is, I don't think that the Israelis were interested in dismembering Syria or dismembering Iraq. I don't think that hardly anybody understood, whether you're talking about Americans or Israelis, that going to war against Iraq, going to war against Syria, would end up with these countries dismembered. I do think, however, that the Israelis, like most American policymakers, were interested in regime change. I think the Israelis have bought on to the regime change argument big time, and they've been pushing us very hard in that direction, which is their right to do. And I think with regard to Iran, right, they would have preferred that we targeted Iran after we did Afghanistan rather than target Iraq. They accepted the fact that we were going to do Iraq because they thought we would do Iran and we would do Syria afterwards, all for the purposes of facilitating regime change, creating a Middle East that was dominated by the United States, looked like the United States, and therefore would behave like the United States, which they thought was in their national interest. The problem with the Israelis is the same problem that the United States has, which is they're not thinking strategically about how to deal with the region. And the end result is we have this giant mess, which is not going to redound to their benefit any more than it's going to redound to our benefit.
Next question.
Todd Pierce, and my question goes to going back to vocabulary, but this panel, I think, captures my question perfectly, and that is the doublespeak that we have as political language, as Orwell wrote. And why I say that is we throw terms about, but it doesn't seem like there's any, if you look underneath them, there's no agreement. What is democracy? Well, we talk about, you know, our goals is to get a democracy in the Middle East, make them look like the U.S. But that's what it's more of a myth. If you look at and Zelma Kalaza just come out with a book talking about the 1992 draft defense planning guidance, where he wrote then, and it's been continued through the national strategy documents ever since, basically our goal with the collapse of the Soviet Union was to maintain our military domination over the world now. PNAC made it clear that their intent and their advice to Netanyahu was to fragment all of the Mideastern countries, not to just regime change. So the question Ray just asked about breaking these countries up, well, that's always been an objective. So the problem seems to be, and here's my question is, do we even agree on the definitions of what our objectives are? Or when we talk about democracy, are we really maybe using, or should we be using, Jacob Taelman's definition of it as totalitarian democracy in the way we're using it today? So the problem seems to be we don't even have a common language anymore when we talk about foreign policy. So perhaps you could address that a bit.
I'm not sure we ever did. I mean, I do think much of the language that we use, look, it's political. This foreign policy is political in nature, period. So how the language comes across to the voter, to the member, to the ally or partner, to the adversary, it's all going to be under some set of perceptions that are running through their heads. We could absolutely do a better job of defining in more detail what we mean. I'm not sure that counts as doublespeak, but I, you know, I hold open the possibility that it has at times. But yeah, I think having a language that's more down at an everyman level that that is commonly understood would be advantageous. I'm not sure it's an ideal we'll ever achieve in all cases, but we could do a much better job.
Just very quickly, I think that there's no question that the United States has dominated the intellectual discourse around the world for a number of decades now. And that intellectual discourse is basically a liberal democratic discourse. And liberal democracy is a wonderful thing. I'm very thankful that I live in a liberal democracy. I don't think that liberalism is good for foreign policy, but in terms of domestic politics, it's really wonderful. And other people around the world understand that, and they glom on to that rhetoric. So we have a situation where everybody tries to justify their behavior, no matter what the motive, in terms of liberal democracy, or in terms of the values and the terminology that attend liberal democracy. And the end result is that you get a great deal of hypocrisy, and you get people acting in ways that don't look very democratic to some people, but do to other people. And I think that this is the principal source of the problem.
Okay, last question down here in front.
Ted Galing, Carpenter, Cato Institute. I'd like you to address the question of when, under what circumstances, the United States should add allies. Because especially in the context of NATO, I think we have had the seriousness and selectivity that some people have when adding Facebook friends. It's my view that when we add allies, it should be because an ally truly enhances the security and well-being of the American people, not because we have some ethereal concept that it's promoting a general good or anything of the sort. And the expansion of NATO seemed to be done with a very vague concept that this was going to improve the security of the Western world, nothing much more than that. So I would like to ask you, what standards would you use about when the United States should add allies, especially when you have something like an Article 5 guarantee? When should the United States be willing to go to war to protect the security of another country? That's rather serious business.
Indeed,
we
it is.
We are doing that with regard to the NATO alliance. Are we really willing to go to war to defend the Baltic Republics or Montenegro
allies? It's a great question, Ted. What would be the criteria for concluding an alliance? Kathleen?
Sure. I think you have the basic formula right. You're looking for, if the United States were looking today for new allies, and honestly, I can't think of one right now that we would be really focused on, but were we to do that, I think we would be looking to see, do we have a commonality of interests? Do they have capacity and capability to contribute to that alliance? And again, I'm thinking military alliance because that's the way you framed it, as opposed to a trade partner or something. Do we have the wherewithal to back up the commitment and they to us? Presumably it's a mutual security alliance. So I think those are the key factors that you would be looking for. I am not on Facebook. I will defer to you on the selection process of Facebook friends.
There's one person not on there.
Yeah, there you go. But so I don't know about the analogy, but I think as much as I expressed concern about the way in which NATO launcher was pursued, I don't think it was done without real debate, without, serious thought, and I think it's unfair to those countries who are members of NATO who are in the later rounds to treat them. They're in NATO now. They should not be treated as less than up to the equal protection under Article 5, and that's how I feel about the Baltic states.
John?
Like Kathleen, I'm not on Facebook either.
too.
My view is very simple. There are three areas of the world that matter to the United States: Europe, Northeast Asia, and the Gulf. And they matter in the sense that I want to make sure there's no single power that dominates any one of those three regions. So the only time I'm even going to think about allies is when there's a potential hegemon in one of those regions. When there is a potential hegemon in one of those regions, my basic goal is to get the local powers to do the heavy lifting against that potential threat, not for us to do it. I'm heavily into buck passing, okay? The name of the game is to get others to do the heavy lifting, not us. But that doesn't mean we can't have allies in that context and give those countries material aid or advice. Okay, and the only circumstance under which I would go in and actually do the fighting is if the locals cannot contain that emerging or potential hegemon. With regard to Europe, which we've focused a lot of attention on, I don't think we should be adding allies, we should be eliminating allies. I have nothing against the Germans, nothing against the French, nothing against the British, but the idea that we should have some military alliance to protect them is, in my opinion, foolish. Have you been to LaGuardia Airport? Have you been to LAX? These are third world airports. Do you know what's happening to the Washington Metro, the New York subway system, the Chicago subway system? They're falling apart. We have huge infrastructure problems in this country. You go to Poland. I was in Poland in December. They have a beautiful new airport. There are beautiful new airports all over Europe. Go to Shanghai, go to Beijing. And you know, the Chinese are not out fighting all these crazy wars, right? They have beautiful airports. And we have spent, the estimates are, $4 to $6 trillion in Iraq and Afghanistan. This is just nuts. We need to pull back, stop fighting all these wars, stop defending rich people who are fully capable of defending themselves, and instead spend the money at home. Period. End of story.
I respond to that? I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
I have to make, therefore,
in this credit, a very unpopular comment. I completely agree on infrastructure. We have a D rating in the United States on infrastructure. It's absolutely outrageous for a country of our wealth and capability. Military operations abroad are definitely a major contributor to fiscal problems. There's no doubt about it. What we invest in allies is way overstated financially. I don't want people to walk away from here conflating U.S.-French military alliance with the cost of operating in Iraq, our choice, or Afghanistan, our choice. Those are not the same thing. And I don't think the investment that we make in allies is a bad investment. I think it's, in fact, an incredibly smart investment for the United States. If we're going to manage risk in the world, we do it in a way that's pretty smart. Do we want allies to contribute more? Absolutely, and they should. Don't take my saying that to in any way take off the pedal, emphasis. But I don't think we should conflate the problems that we have at home entirely with what we spend in order to maintain an alliance structure abroad.
Well, thank you very much, Dr. Hicks and Dr. Mearsheimer. I think you can see here that we're having a wonderful, diverse conversation this morning, and I was really excited by what you all said. At this point in the program, we're going to take a brief break. Please help yourself to coffee and refreshments in the foyer, and take some time to review our foreign policy library, where you will find many of the books by people on this stage. And we'll reconvene at 11:20 sharp, so thank you very much.